Next Sunday, the guest speaker will be David Whitmarsh. He's from the charity Compassion, with the idea of sponsoring children throughout the world. So it should be a very interesting talk. There will be a retiring collection for that cause, so if anybody's coming next week, could keep that in mind, please. There is obviously a very bad situation in Turkey and Syria at the moment. Now, the moderator has written a letter to Kirk Sessions and to churches. Basically, what he's saying is that a lot of people are struggling now with the cost of living, and he's not actually going to make an appeal, but he is recommending that we support Christian Aid and Tear Fund at this time. So if anybody wants to support the cause, they can support Tear Fund. Now, there's information on the leaflet. The letter which he has sent is also on the notice board outside. So if anybody would like to donate to those causes, please do so. And please remember these people in your prayers. They're going through an awful time just at the moment. There's a divine healing service in St. Sedma's Sunday the 19th of February at 3 p.m. And then last but not least, for the gentlemen or boys in the audience. Now, this is not just, it is just for gentlemen or boys, this one, so sorry, ladies. We're going to the Ulster Aviation Society on the 18th of March. So there is a sign-up sheet in the vestibule, so if anybody would like to go along to that, sign up on the sheet and speak to the Reverend Andrew if you want any further information. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Good to see you. Welcome to church today. Now, do you like my friendship bracelet? The Girls Brigade were making these yesterday morning, and I'm chuffed to bits to have one of these. And Hazel got a lovely necklace as well, so thank you to the girls for that. And does anybody know what day it is on Tuesday? I wouldn't know this. Tuesday, February the 14th or something. Alpha. Oh, yes, Valentine's Day. Do you know what? I had a very suspicious look in the post office the other day. I was in the post office and I was sending two Valentine cards. And the girl behind the counter looked at me very strangely. She thought, So what are you up to, sir? You know, two Valentine's cards. You should only be one. But you see, I've got two daughters who even in their 20s still like to get a wee card from their daddy. So that's, it was okay. There was nothing suspicious about it at all. Anyway, I thought it might be nice. You know, you might get a Valentine's card on Tuesday or you might not. But one thing that I am fairly confident about is that God loves you. And so, do you know what I'm going to suggest to you? I'm going to suggest that we turn to each other, greet one another, say good morning. God loves you. Shall we do that? What about it for Valentine's week? Good morning, Sylvia. God bless you. Good morning.
Alfie. Alfie. God loves you.
God loves you. God loves you. Very good. Could we invite our singers to come forward, please? We've got a song. These words are from the Bible. Therefore, the redeemed of the Lord shall return and come with singing unto Zion, and everlasting joy shall be upon their head.
Return and come to see unto Zion.
As we were singing, it's good to praise God and to do so joyfully. Let's stand and sing a hymn now. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven. To his feet thy tribute bring. Ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven. Who like me his praise should sing? We'll stand to sing, shall we?
So the King of Heaven, to his feet thy tribute bring. Ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven, who like me his praise should sing. Praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him.
In prayer before the Almighty, shall we? Let me lead you in prayer. In a moment, we'll join our voices together in saying the words that Jesus taught, the Lord's Prayer. Let's pray. Almighty God, our gracious, loving Father in heaven, thank you for another blessed opportunity to come into your holy presence together in the name of Jesus. Thank you that we may approach you and speak with the Almighty, the Creator, the Ruler of heaven and earth. We praise you, for there's no one else quite like you. No one else is your equal, nor indeed anywhere near. You alone are God.
And so we bow our heads before you in absolute respect and reverence. And we rejoice, we are glad, we celebrate that you are there, that you are real. We're not atheists, we don't believe there's nothing. How dreadful that would be. We're glad that you have revealed yourself through the ages, through your word, through scripture, and ultimately through your Son, the Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, Son of God, for living here among us and for revealing to us the character of our Heavenly Father, that you are holy, but you are also loving and gracious. And we're so grateful because we need grace. We need forgiveness. We need your love. We need to know that we are accepted and that we are promised eternal life. And we thank you that that is so in Jesus, the King. So, Lord, today will you accept our praise, our thanksgiving, and our trust for today and for the days ahead. We don't know what this week might bring, but you do. And we thank you that you are in charge and that you are well able to provide all our needs. So we're trusting in you. We're asking for your help. We pray, dear Lord, that today you would help us to listen carefully to the words from your word, your truth, your wisdom. And dear Lord, will you help us to be wise enough to take it on board and to put it into practice in our lives. And so may we know your blessing, your grace, your peace in our lives. Dear Lord, hear us as we pray, not only for ourselves, but for those dear to us, family, neighbors, friends, work colleagues, friends in school or in college. Dear Lord, we pray that you would hear us as we lift them up before you and ask that your kingdom would come in their lives, that they would know your love, and your power to change for good. So, dear Lord, hear these and all our prayers, which we offer to you in the name of Jesus, who taught his followers to pray like this. We say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now, our reading from Matthew chapter 5. It's the beginning of Jesus' famous Sermon on the Mount, the bit that we call the Beatitudes. It's going to be read for us by Irene. Thank you, Irene.
Now, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Amen.
Thank you, Irene. Now, Hazel and I were the guests of the PW last Monday, the PW, the Presbyterian Women, and we had a lovely afternoon together. And one of the traditional strengths of this organization, the Presbyterian Women, is that they take an interest in mission and in our personnel, our deaconesses, our chaplains, and pray for this work. Now, last Sunday, you might have got your Presbyterian Herald magazine, and you might have been reading about some of our various workers in different circumstances. And I've asked Helen and Jenny to come and lead us in prayer for a couple of these folk today. So would you ladies like to come forward and lead us in prayer, please? Thank you.
One of the people we are thinking about today is the Reverend Leslie Ann Wilson, who was appointed last year as lead chaplain in Woodlands Juvenile Justice Centre in Bangor, where there are three houses for boys and one for girls. She deals with teenagers, listening, chatting, and praying with them, talking about her faith in Christ, sharing a Bible story, giving encouragement, or whatever seems appropriate. So let us pray. Dear Father in Heaven, we pray for Leslie Ann in her role as lead chaplain at Woodlands, that she would know your blessing and guidance in her interaction with the young people. May she have increased opportunities to share her faith. We ask you, Lord, that the young people entering Woodlands could be encouraged and comforted by the support and prayers of Leslie Ann and the pastoral team, and find faith and a new life in Christ. In your name we ask it. Amen.
I'd like to bring to you Steve and Rosie Kennedy, who are global mission workers in Cluj-Napoca in Romania. They describe their focus in their position as serving the people of who God brings to them. And currently one of the key groups they support is the Ukrainian community, who have fled to Romania to escape the war. Alongside the Tokos Church and partner organisations, they seek to provide practical support, education for the children, mother and baby groups, an after-school club and English classes. An essential aspect of their work is to develop a sense of community which encompasses all the groups they work with and helps them to feel integrated into the area and cared for. If we can pray for them, please. Heavenly Father, we pray for an end to the continuing conflict in Ukraine. We pray for your mercy and comfort for those families who are separated from each other and from their homes. We pray for the current projects in Tokos and its English ministry. Give them wisdom and guidance as more projects develop, reflecting the needs of the Ukrainian community. We thank you and praise you, Father, for the involvement of the Ukrainian community in the church, and pray for more opportunities to share the faith and hope of the gospel among the people groups there. Bless them, Father. We ask all of this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Thank you, Jenny and Helen and Irene. Boys and girls, it's almost time for Sunday school. Ooh, but we're going to sing a song first. Just before we do, can I say to you that there is a little printed prayer on the table in the vestibule that you might find helpful. If you were watching the video, the church video on Facebook this week, I usually put a little reading in the middle of the week on the church Facebook page, and it had this week not just a Bible reading, but it had a prayer as well. And it was really just an attempt to respond in faith to the awful things that we were seeing on the news in Turkey and Syria, and indeed closer to home as well. And if you thought that prayer was helpful, or if you didn't hear it, there's a printed prayer, copies of it on the vestibule table. If you would like to take one, you're more than welcome. If that would be helpful to you, please do take one. We're going to sing together now, and we're going to sing this lovely song, I Will Offer Up My Life.
And there's going to be quite a short introduction, so could I suggest that we stand together now?
I will offer my love in spirit and truth, pouring out the oil of love as my worship to you. In surrender I must give my every part. Lord, receive the sacrifice of a broken heart. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring to so faithful a friend, to so loving a king? Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of your name for the things you have done? Oh, my words would not tell, not even in part, of the debt of love that is owed by this thankful heart. You deserve my every breath, for you paid the great cost, giving up your life to death, even death on a cross. You took all my shame away, there defeated my sin, opened up the gates of heaven, and have beckoned me in. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring to so faithful a friend, to so loving a king? Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of your name for the things you have done? Oh, my words could not tell, not even in part, of the debt of love that is owed by this thankful heart.
Boys and girls, Sunday school time. We'll see you again at the end, okay? Just play that through, maybe. Okay. Following on the theme of that song, let's continue to worship God as we bring him our offering now. Your offering will be received. Thank you. Let's pray. Faithful one, so unchanging, you are our rock. You are our king. You are our friend. We give you our praise. We offer these gifts and ourselves in your service for your glory. Amen. going to sing again. I'm going to sing another really very prayerful song, Thy Kingdom Come, O God. In case you hadn't picked up yet, our theme today from the Lord's Prayer is Thy Kingdom Come, Your Kingdom Come. What does that mean? We'll be thinking about that in a moment. But let's turn the thought prayerful in our next hymn as we stand and sing together, Thy Kingdom Come, O God. This next reading is from the Old Testament. It's from the book of Daniel, chapter 2, and it might seem a little strange at first because it's dramatic picture language. It's about 600 years before Christ was born. Daniel has been deported from Jerusalem, which has been overthrown, and made to serve King Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon. And yet the book of Daniel, if it has one message, it's perhaps this, that God is still in control. Even in a foreign country, even as a tiny minority of faith in a secular culture. Well, God gives, not Daniel, but the king, an intriguing dream. Very dramatic, very memorable, and the king is disturbed. What does it mean? Who is going to interpret it for him? And after some investigation, the only person who seems able to know his dream and interpret it is this young exile from Jerusalem, a slave, a servant. So Daniel comes in and begins to explain. God has given him the explanation of the dream. And we'll see in a moment or two. Just please bear with me. We'll see what it's all about. So Daniel is speaking to the king and he says, Your Majesty looked in your dream and there before you stood a large statue, an enormous, dazzling statue, awesome in appearance. The head of the statue was made of pure gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of baked clay. While you were watching, a rock was cut out, but not by human hands. It struck the statue on its feet of iron and clay and smashed them. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were all broken to pieces and became like chaff on a threshing floor in the summer. The wind swept them away without leaving a trace. But the rock that struck the statue became a huge mountain and filled the whole earth. This was the dream, and now we will interpret it to the king. Your Majesty, you are the King of Kings. The God of heaven has given you dominion and power and might and glory. In your hands he has placed all mankind and the beasts of the field and the birds in the sky. Wherever they live, he has made you ruler over them all. You are that head of gold. After you, another kingdom will arise, inferior to yours. Next, a third kingdom, one of bronze, will rule over the whole earth. Finally, there will be a fourth kingdom, strong as iron, for iron breaks and smashes everything. And as iron breaks things to pieces, so it will crush and break all the others. Just as you saw that the feet and toes were partly baked clay, partly of iron, so this will be a divided kingdom. Yet it will have some of the strength of iron in it, even as you saw iron mixed with clay. As the toes were partly iron, partly clay, so this kingdom will be partly strong, partly brittle. Just as you saw the iron mixed with baked clay, so the people will be a mixture and will not remain united any more than iron mixes with clay. In the time of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another people. It will crush all those kingdoms and bring them to an end, but it will itself endure forever. This is the meaning of the vision of the rock cut out of a mountain, but not by human hands. A rock that broke the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold to pieces. The great God has shown the king what will take place in the future. The dream is true, and its interpretation is trustworthy. Amen. May God bless his word to us today. I don't think any of you would contradict me if I said prayer is important. I think probably everyone here would agree with that. Prayer is important, but if we're absolutely honest, we might admit that sometimes we don't find it that easy. Well, yes, we can say something like, oh God, please forgive us if we're feeling bad about something. Please, God, bless us and our families and friends, those we care about. And God, maybe be with and help those who are in need today. Maybe those poor people in Turkey, Syria. But beyond that, we maybe aren't very sure what else to say. What would God want us to say? And thankfully, someone asked Jesus about this, and the witnesses recorded the pattern for prayer the Lord, the Son of God himself, has given us. And so as we read the Lord's Prayer, we find that Jesus instructs his followers, may approach God as our Abba, a good and loving Father who reigns in heaven, and that we should hallow his name. That is, we should seek first and foremost to honor and glorify him, not just in our words, but with obedient lives. And next, Jesus teaches his followers to pray, your kingdom come. What does that mean? Well, let's consider a little bit of the background, shall we? Excuse me. The nation of Israel had a kingdom in the Old Testament. Under David and Solomon, it prospered and flourished and became quite a power in the Middle East. Later, it became divided and was overthrown by Assyria and Babylon, the rising superpowers in those days. Now, the prophets in the Old Testament put this down to many of the kings and people disobeying the laws God had given through Moses and worshipping alternative idols. And so as we read in Isaiah and Jeremiah and so on, constantly we see this message. Look, God was blessing you. You were doing perfectly well while you were obedient. But when you turned against God, God has withdrawn his protection. That's why this is happening. The Old Testament kingdom of Israel fell. However, God had promised a throne and a kingdom to one of David's descendants forever. Isaiah predicted discipline and exile in the short term, but restoration in future years through a God-given Messiah, a royal Savior. So we find that in the early chapters of Isaiah, and it's quite a long book, you'll find messages really of warning. Look, you're disobeying God. You're asking for trouble. You're going to experience suffering and exile because of your disobedience, your idolatry. But then as we read on, we find also these wonderful passages where Isaiah looks beyond the discipline and says, ah, yes, but God will not forget his promises. And there will be a time of renewal and restoration. There will be a servant of the Lord who will come. There will be a righteous branch. There will be a descendant of David, a royal one who will come. And in his time, things will start to be put right. And indeed, those very words that the singers sang at the start of the service. Therefore, the redeemed of the Lord shall return and come with singing to Zion. Everlasting joy will be their inheritance. Where do those words come from? Isaiah, the prophet, looking beyond the short term, which could be sad and difficult. There would be a time of renewal, a time of restoration. Okay, Daniel, the bit we read a moment ago, what's that got to do with it? Well, Daniel was given a vision of hope through the dream of the pagan king Nebuchadnezzar. And God was giving quite specific, quite detailed predictions. After a succession of human empires, God would establish his never-ending kingdom, which would be nothing less than global. It would fill the whole earth, and it would be never-ending. So imagine ourselves in the first century AD. Historians have been counting kingdoms and assessing things very carefully. And so Babylon had come and gone. So had Medo-Persia. Then there was Greece, Alexander the Great and all those boys. And then they had the Romans, the feet of Nebuchadnezzar's statue. So surely it was time for God's kingdom to appear. And that might explain why some people got very excited when a preacher from Galilee started announcing, the time has come. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news. Who said that? It was Jesus. We read that in the opening chapters of the Gospels. What was Jesus' message? The kingdom is at hand. The kingdom is near. The kingdom is coming. You need to prepare. You need to repent and believe the good news. Now, people were especially interested because this preacher, now there had been lots of preachers, and there had been quite a few people who had even claimed to be the Messiah who hadn't been the Messiah. But this one, well, he was backing up his message with the sort of miracles only God could authorize. So could this Jesus of Nazareth be the king God had promised? Could God be keeping his promises through Isaiah and Daniel? Was he coming at last to rescue his people? Now, the tragedy of our human response to God is that so often we settle for less than God wants to actually give. Most first century Jews seem to have thought of the kingdom in mere physical terms. They saw it simply as being about territory victory over enemies like the Romans, national independence, material prosperity, the sort of thing they read about in their Hebrew scriptures back in the days of Solomon. That sounded great. Could we have some more of that, please, God? Well, our Father in heaven, in his grace and kindness, can and often does bless people in the here and now with things like these. But the Lord wants to give us more. He wants to deliver us from spiritual evil. He wants to cleanse us and release us from our burdens of guilt. He wants to comfort our fear and anxiety with the assurance of his peace. He wants to cure our confusion, leading us in paths of truth and righteousness. Above all, he wants us to be reconciled to him and know his love, restoring our souls to enjoy wholeness of life in every way, eternally. We would just settle for a little bit of territory and a little bit of money in the bank account and be quite happy with that. Oh no, our Father in heaven wants to bless us so much more generously than that. And it's not just for one ethnic group, as the prophets predicted. This kingdom opens its doors to people of all nations and backgrounds. Anyone who recognizes their poverty of spirit without God and turns to the Christ he has given. Anyone who mourns for their sin and turns from it and hungers and thirsts for righteousness. Any such person may come and find welcome and blessing in this kingdom, according to Jesus. So, what does it mean then for us to pray as we do here each week? Your kingdom come. Well, God has always reigned sovereign over all he has made. The Creator is already the King, surely. And Jesus, well, he has finished the work of atonement at Calvary. He did it that day when he died on the cross. He has risen in victory. He has ascended to share the Father's throne in heaven. He is already King of Kings. So we're not praying for God to become the king. We're praying for the world to recognize him as king and Jesus, the Son, as King of Kings. We're praying for his influence to be effective far and wide here and now. We're praying for the influence of the king in our lives and the lives of those around us to the far ends of the earth. Specifically, we're praying for salvation. Sorry, can we go back one? Salvation through the King. Now, this is an uncomfortable truth, but it's one we have to face, Cairncastle. Many people in the world, spiritually, are still outside of God's kingdom and are spiritually lost. Not everyone is on their way to heaven at the moment. Jesus spoke about a broad road that leads to destruction and that there were many on it. We don't like to think about that, but that's something that our Lord teaches that we have to face up to. And so we pray, your kingdom come. We pray salvation through King Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Send your spirit to bring conviction about sin and our need for Jesus to many, many more people in this area, in this country, in this world. Open blind eyes and closed hearts. Your kingdom come. Bring people to repentance and faith. Release those bound in darkness. Give new strength to those paralyzed in bitterness or fear. Lord, your kingdom come. Flood our consciousness with fresh life and joy, the kind of joy Isaiah predicted in his preaching and writing. Our Father, bring into your kingdom family, to your house, to your table, our families, our neighbors, our work colleagues, our friends. Father, do that for which Christ suffered and died. Lord, save. Salvation through the King. That's what we're praying when we say here every Sunday, Thy kingdom come. There's more. We're also praying for widespread submission to the King. Communities, nations, governments are currently floundering under the limited solutions proposed by flawed yet still proud human beings like us. I suggest to you we need more than new policies. We need populations of people renewed in heart and mind by the teaching and example of the Lord Jesus. So we pray, Lord, your kingdom come. May we not just take on the name of the King in a nominal way, but may we submit to the King, to obeying the King, to serving the King, not just we ourselves, but many, many people. May we become a population of people who want to serve King Jesus. What does that mean? Well, Lord, will you teach us? Will you enable us to follow the wisdom of your word? Stop trying to make up our own wisdom and follow some of the latest ideas of this world. May we return to the wisdom that you have revealed in Scripture. Will you lead hundreds and thousands of people in this country and all over the world to study Scripture and practice and promote its truth? Will you inspire us, Father, to live with courage, integrity, humility, compassion? Will you deliver us from our slavery to consumerism and selfish pleasure? Father, will you end abuse? Will you bring about conscience, renewed conscience in our day, that people would once more be afraid to commit evil? Will you renew our communities in reverence and gratitude and desire to serve one another for the common good? Father, your kingdom come, refresh us in your wisdom, in your truth, in your word. Submission to the King. Don't wear a badge that says, I'm a follower of Jesus, if you're not actually going to follow him. We don't only trust him as Savior, we are to submit to him as Lord and King. And as we do so, as we pray, we look forward to celebration with the King. In the last few verses, literally the last page or two of the Bible, the last few verses of God's inspired word, Jesus assures his followers he is coming soon. And among the last few words of the Bible, the apostle replies, Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Did you know? That's one of the last things that's inspired in the Word of God. It's a prayer. Come, Lord Jesus. Your kingdom come. King Jesus, come. A little earlier in the book of Revelation, we have a picture of Jesus coming in the clouds at the head of the armies of heaven. Now that hasn't happened yet, but it's coming. The picture that we're given is of Jesus like a general, like the king leading his armies, the hosts of heaven, coming on the clouds. Once and for all, the Lord defeats Satan, who is cast into a lake of fire along with all those who have followed his lies. Shortly after this, John is given a glimpse of the kingdom come in all its glory, when God makes all things new, when he wipes tears from the eyes of those who have trusted and followed him, when all his children from every nation are welcomed into the new Jerusalem. Jesus assures us God's kingdom is near. Spiritual reality is much closer than we think. For now, we can't see it. We can see the effect, some of the effects, but we don't see the Lord in the clouds just yet. But one day soon, we will. The Bible says every eye will see him. There will be no doubt as the King returns visibly in glory. Christians look forward to this celebration. We long for his appearing. And yet even now, today, the kingdom's influence can be very real and very profound for us as individuals and as a community of people as we trust in Jesus, Savior, and submit to him as King. May it be so for his glory. Your kingdom come, Cairncastle. Yes, Lord. Amen. Our closing prayers. This may be a new hymn for us here. It's not difficult to learn, and the words are wonderful. Again, picking up on Scripture, particularly the book of Revelation, looking forward to the return of our King. So let's stand and we'll sing this together. There's a sound on the wind like a victory song. Listen, let it rest on your soul. A song that I learned from a heavenly King, the song of a battle royal. We stand to sing. Until that day, Lord, we pray that you would, by your Spirit, fill us and lead us, equip us, inspire us, motivate us, help us to serve you. May your kingdom come in us and among us here in Cairncastle. We thank you for the refreshments provided. We invite your presence and your blessing with us as we stay in fellowship together. Hear us now as we join our voices in the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.